Hi, I'm Jim with the Mad River Mountain Ski Patrol. We're going to review the use of the vacuum splint, or specifically the full body vacuum splint. Use for it as a replacement for a backboard for a spinal immobilization. It has the advantage that it's going to fill all the voids. We don't need to pad anything. We can also conform to the position the patient is in. Once we've obtained the vacuum splint from the storage location, take it to the place we're going to use it. We're going to open up the packaging. So let's take a look and see what we have packaged with the vacuum splint here at Mad River Mountain. Unzip and open, and on the top is our vacuum splint. There is a pump for evacuating the air out of the vacuum splint. And then with ours in the kit, we also are keeping a mega mover. This is a large tarp device with straps and handles on it to assist in moving. This can be lifted by two people, but if it's a larger person, we need to have more people with the lift. This can be placed underneath it. It'll give us about 8 different positions people can grab on the handles so we can carry it more easily over rough terrain. All right, at this point, we've assessed our patient. We've determined they have an injury where we want to see spine immobilize the patient. Instead of putting them on a backboard, we are going to use the vacuum splint. Again, this is a more positive immobilization. It allows less movement than the spine board does. It does not create the pressure points that the spine board does, and it conforms to the patient if they're in a slightly unusual position. We've taken it out. It comes folded like this. We are going to unfold it. And then initially it's going to come out that it is fairly movable. There's no stiffness to it. If it is stiff, too stiff, I have a valve at the right foot and I have a valve at the left side of the patient's head. There's a yellow circle icon over top of each valve to show you where it is located. We remove the red cap. I depress the red button that allows air to move into the device. That'll allow it to become flexible. I'm going to very quickly smooth it out so that I have a flat surface. Monty is then going to connect the pump up there at that end, and we are going to take air out of the system. We're not blowing up, we are removing air. For patrollers, one thing to note, especially in the snow, when these valves are open, the protective cover's off, I can get snow and debris inside there, which can make my splint not operate. So make sure I'm protecting this. If I'm not letting air in or out, I'm keeping my protective cover in place. He's going to pull out enough air to make this stiff. Take a little bit more.
That's good.
At this point, it's kind of like our backboard that we're used to using. It has some rigidity to it. We place it beside our patient. Remember, when I log roll, my patient normally is not going to be centered. I have two options for how I can place the patient, same as when I'm backboard. I can place the board in position here, and then if to center the patient, I slide down, slide up, or I can position this above the patient's head. When we go to log roll, and we'll slide it under, and then we only can do it, slide it one motion going up. Because of our person holding C-spine in here, we're going to go ahead and position it like we traditionally do a backboard. And we're going to undo the buckles on the side closer to the patient, pull them off to this side.
What happened?
All right. My person at the head has C-spine control. I have two assistants or three assistants who assist me doing a log roll. And I'm going to place this just as I would place a backboard. On the heads count, we are going to log roll.
One, 2, 3.
I'm going to slide this into position. If you've not done so already, this is a time to assess your patient's spine for any injuries. And then on the head count, we are going to log roll the person back.
1, 2, 3.
At this point, he's not centered. We're going to slide him down and then slide him over again on the person the heads count.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
At the top or the head of the splint, there is a yellow circle. That's my marker where I want my patient's head to be placed.
You took it off when you got to the bottom.
Once the position is in patient is in position,
have you ever,
we're going to reconnect the belts.
Have you ever hurt yourself?
On this, you'll notice there are white buckles on one side of the patient, black buckles on the other side of the patient. And you connect the white to white, black to black.
Slack.
We need to let some air into the so we can move this. Push down.
Are you on any medication?
Once we've let air in, this is now flexible again, so get while some slack so we can connect the buckles.
Where's this jacket at? In the locker room. Are these rentals from here?
This system uses a continuous belt. Okay. To hold the splint or the vacuum splint in place. These are not like seat belts that are securing them to it. It is more to secure the splint around the patient. So we begin by pulling a little bit of slack out at the top, and then we work down. I pull slack out to his side, pull slack back. As we're doing this, we're conforming the splint to the patient.
Pull the splint up on that side.
If I still need additional slack pulled out when these buckles get too close together, I simply reverse the process and I can take the additional slack out up here at the head. Make sure this is secured snugly close to the patient all the way up and down. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to prepare the head. The vacuum splint will become my head immobilizers as well. So I'm going to move this into position close to the head. He's going to rotate his hands outside of the splint and take over holding this in place. We are then going to remove all of the air from the splint. It will conform, it will become rigid, but it does not compress the patient. It forms around the patient without actually applying pressure. You can feel the splint. Once you feel it become rigid, we have enough air, and we will disconnect. If they push button release, he pulls that off, and we replace the cap to prevent debris from getting in. At this point, I would complete my assessment, circulation, movement, sensation in each of the extremities, and then I'm ready to be able to move the patient. Notice the splint has become my head immobilizer. It is conformed to the patient, and he is fully immobilized. There are handles on each side of the splint. This can be used to carry the patient. I do not carry from the head and the feet. I can only carry this patient from the sides using these handles. If I need to position more people around or if I need additional assistance, that's where we have the mega mover that we can place underneath this. I can place a traditional backboard under this. I can place the person into a litter, onto a cot, or into a Stokes basket with this to allow caring from additional positions or additional people to assist us.
Dude, this is gonna be awesome.
That's the basic steps for using this splint. Once they're mobilized in this, they will be transported to the hospital in this, and it is removed at the hospital by the hospital staff when they decide it's appropriate for patient care reasons. To remove it, it is simply opening protective cover at either end, depress the button, and allow air to get back into the splint. As it does that, it becomes flexible again. We release the buckles, and the splint can be removed. I like the stairs so deep in